Hi, and welcome to Telepathic TV. This is television you watch with your third eye, and I'm R. Neville Johnston.
And I'm Mary Phelan, and our program is about raising our consciousness.
Indeed. Raising consciousness very much is changing the way in which you think. It's changing the way the words you think in. We've seen people that take in a healing process that is a normal process after an event. And then once the language around it changes, once the person that you can say that they've died instead of they've passed, that you can just be okay with it, mm-hmm. is indicative of this healing process. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you go directly to it, then the healing occurs. Mm. It is about the way in which we language everything, because the name of the game here on the planet Earth. Mm. And there are other languages coming into existence, languages without words. And this is, after all, telepathic TV. And the telepathy is something that we're working up. I can feel a class coming eventually on the subject of telepathy. Just a few ticks away. Here it comes.
So. Well, I've been teaching a class that addresses that for a long time, which mm-hmm. we'll schedule pretty soon.
Excellent.
But you're right. You know, we really do communicate. Most of our communication is unspoken, more said in the pauses between words than in the words themselves. And there's also a carrier wave that the words ride on. So there's all kinds of ways we communicate. If we focus our attention, actually if we soften our focus and make it more across the board where we're sensing with all of our resources instead of just our ears and eyes.
Yeah, I remember being a young child and remembering how to paint, and I would purposely put my eyes out of focus to understand what colors I was looking at, mm-hmm. and, you know, selecting the palette to do the rendering of whatever it was I was painting. It's a very interesting concept,
yeah.
Not being so in the mind about things and more in
yes.
feelings.
Well, tonight we're keeping an open forum, so if anybody would like to call in with a question, you know, it's really a good idea because this is such a great place to start a dialogue that is very interesting. So your question will be, benefit everybody.
Yeah, if you've had a dream, for example, this is always mysterious, or appears mm-hmm. to be mysterious. A dream we might interpret for you. Any piece of reality that puzzles you in any way, any concept that it might be that you'd like further information on understanding, digesting, transmuting, and raising the consciousness about any given event in your life, we'd be very happy to do that. The distance between the event and the recognition of the event is a blessing, because everything's a blessing. That distance is in fear, doubt, worry, and guilt. That's the distance. If there were no fear, doubt, worry, and guilt, everything would instantly be recognizable as a blessing.
Mm-hmm. That's very true. Well, also, the last email that I sent out, and by the way, if you want to be on the email list, just go to telepathictv.com and you can sign up on all the pages there. But I sent out links to the most recent shows, and I asked if viewers have questions to go ahead and email them in, because not everybody watches us live on Thursday night. Sometimes you're watching the re-airing on Friday morning or on Saturday evening at 10 o'clock, or you're watching it on the internet. So you can email us at telepathictv@yahoo.com, and we'll put some questions on the list. And so a few viewers have done that, so I thought, why don't we start off maybe, and I know I haven't even read these questions to you. Sue wrote that she'd like to hear our thoughts on personal power in relationships and how to sort out what's your issues over what's their issues, which is an excellent question, because what happens when we get into a relationship, we're very much like two plants growing together. The roots get entwined with each other and so do the leaves, and it's really important when you're finding your power is where you are and where they are and what is the relationship. So if you have some
thoughts.
Well,
I would love to believe that there is separation the way she's describing it. And whatever the, don't care for the word issue, because that's a word that has pre-decided that there's something the matter. But whatever that person is, is a mirror, a harmony to you. We love to believe that they're two separate individuals, but when there's this relationship, they are just mirroring back and forth to each other what's going on. So whatever that is that they're mirroring back, that has to be solved within you, not them. As long as you believe it's them, then you're playing the blame game. In fact, the use of the word them just outlines that perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
So we can blame anyone for anything and count on coming back for another lifetime. But so what passes for thinking is called the blame game. And that's where you, and we have our first caller. One moment.
Yeah, we'll get back to that.
Sure,
because I have a lot more to say,
okay.
too.
Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
Hi, this is Chris.
Chris, what can we do for you?
Well, I just want to say I love the show. I find it very fruitful and rewarding.
Huh. And you're on a cell phone, I'm going to bet.
Oh, gosh. Is it breaking up?
Breaking up a little. Yeah. Yeah, but go ahead. I'm sure we can still make it out.
Yeah, just state the question.
Okay, I'll do my best. Pretty much something very weird has been happening in the morning. When I wake up, there's like a force that doesn't let me get up for about maybe 10, 15 seconds. And I'm just trying to get your opinion and what do you think it is.
Well, one thing that this may be, but you know, maybe you can share a little more details about it, but what happens is when our serotonin is converted to melatonin, which tells our body not to move, we get into something called sleep paralysis as we fall asleep. And that actually stays with us all night. That way, when we're dreaming of running around a field, we're not getting up out of bed and running around because it paralyzes our body to the reality that we're experiencing because we're on different levels, we're on different planes. Often, people that are very gifted at lucid dreaming and out-of-body experiences will have these experiences when they're waking up that the consciousness, the everyday consciousness, the one that we go around the, you know, our daily life with, wakes up before the body does. And so it's like you're paralyzed or that you can't get up, you can't move. And I've met a number of people that found this to be a very frightening experience when they didn't know what was going on. And our fear can make it seem like a force stopping us, because in a way it is. It's our body chemistry keeping us back.
Wow. Yes. Does
that make sense to you?
Yeah, it makes perfect sense, because also lately I've been having a lot of lucid dreams. And just dreams I can't really, explain,
mm-hmm.
but the intensity has gone very, very high dreams.
I count that as a very good sign, and that's something you may wish to explore. All kinds of books out there, and next time we do the dream workshop, you might be interested in it, because we talk a little bit about that. But what were you going to say?
Talk quite a bit about it. To convert this fear completely to a blessing, is to understand that this is a very valuable state of mind to be in, because at that moment you are between the worlds. You're not fully conscious and you're not fully asleep. You are between the worlds. Enormous things can be accomplished between the worlds. It is a point of great power. And you can, in training your mind, self-love is self-discipline, in those moments before your body is willing to rejoin 3D and your mind remains between the worlds, tell things to happen. I would suggest that one of the earliest things you can speak in this state of mind is, I claim my power. If you begin every day of your life with the phrase, it's actually a sentence, I claim my power, that is a very different life to live. Very different indeed. We do create 100% of our reality, or we go into denial about that, which doesn't really interest me. What interests me is the recognition that I'm creating my life. And therefore, the question, well, what am I creating? And which is, well, let's say joy. There we go. What would you choose to create with your life? because you're doing that all the time. It's being conscious of it, and that's a very important step to take. So congrats on having fallen into a state of meditation that we would recommend highly. And
yes, actually.
And do something with it.
Yeah, and actually, you know, it's in that state that I receive my greatest teachings.
Yeah.
There came a point in time where I just was led to not read any more books, but just to go inward for certain information.
Yeah.
And that's really my most active time. That's the H, the crossbar of the H, of the waking self and the dreaming self.
Mm-hmm.
So if you find yourself in that place, it's actually a very good sign.
Yeah.
But thank you. That was such an excellent call. Thanks.
Yeah. And what we call lucid dreaming, that's a version of it, so to speak. In other words, you're asleep, but you're awake. Okay. There, you're awake, but you're asleep.
Yeah,
same
well,
thing as lucid dreaming.
Yeah, lucid dreaming is when you
lucid
take your...
Lucid waking.
It's not really that you, all of a sudden, your conscious self goes into the dream with you in lucid dreaming. It's always there. It's just lucid dreaming is you become aware of it and pull it into physical reality.
Mm-hmm.
Likewise, out-of-body experiences are where your dream body or your astral body, whatever, comes into the wake time and can move around, at least the awareness of it. But thank you.
Yeah. So, as always on our show, we are upgrading people to the Mayan calendar, or urine calendar, someone's calendar. And
we'll
the Mayans
calendar
came
behind.
To the planet Earth to map time for us. And their annals have been lost, but they've been reached. Well, that is the way you say that in English, as humorous just as it may be in a sophomoric
it's
way.
It's all right if I laugh, okay?
Yes, it is, okay.
Anyway, what's interesting today is 6 Kawak.
Mm-hmm.
Kawak is the catalyzer. It's the thunder being. It's being a tone 6. Now, one thing that I thought was interesting, because today is the solstice, which is the longest day of the year, and it says I organize in order to catalyze balancing energy. And so today is a day of balancing, the balance point, you know, of the longest day, you know, which is a counterbalance to the shortest day, which just is a very balancing day. Kawak has a lot of balancing energies with it.
And in that sense of the ascending, and in that moment of weightlessness, and then the descending, that's what's going on here.
Yeah.
So it's a very exciting day to be alive, like all days, but for some very specific reasons. Now, get out there and celebrate.
Yeah, stay out late tonight.
Yeah, in fact, join us at Ruby
but
Tuesdays.
But it really does, it's interesting, if you notice that during the winter, it really does feel like shorter days. I'm not talking just daylight hours, but it feels like next thing you know, you're going to bed. And so the length of the day didn't change, but the time changed. So it is our consciousness of time that made one day seem forever. Remember summer days when we were kids?
Summer days.
You know, staying out till 8 or 9 o'clock. It really seemed like there were more hours in the day. So the hours in the day, in other words, are just psychological constructs. So we can make every day last forever.
Come back when the street lights go on.
If you live in the moment, it's always endless foreverness.
Yes. You know, gives us something to do, definitely.
Well, you know, forward to more perspectives on Sue's question about relationships and each person how to sort out what's theirs and what's not. I feel like what she's asking is sometimes, and yes, it is true, everything in a relationship, as a matter of fact, our romantic relationships are the greatest mirrors because it's on so many different levels. That's where we see, like, whatever our relationship, the person in the relationship is doing to us, we're doing to us, and they are like puppets animating that energy that's in our auric field.
Mm-hmm.
We take that and modify that, then the puppet's going to do something different. That is absolutely true. But then there are times where we get very codependent as well, where because we don't want to look at our own things, we will go look at the other person's things. And I think that's what she's talking about. How do I know what's mine and what isn't? Well, anything that comes up for you is you.
Yeah.
But there are certainly things that we take on in order to not have to look at our own stuff. So in that way, it's good to kind of do a sorting out. And when I do private sessions for people, which are really more like coaching sessions to a large degree, I say that sort things out like laundry, like you'd put the colored clothes over here. So often we'll have something going on with a relationship and it's like this big huge mass of clothing or this big piece of food on your plate. We've got to cut it into bite-sized pieces, separate them into piles. This really isn't about me. You know, that's you talking to you and I'm not going to take it personally. And then this is me, this is my mirror. It's very helpful to sort it out.
Yeah, and we must explain the blame game, which is very much the driving engine in this confusion that Sue's talking about, which is that the one and only thinking, and that has to be in quotes, that occurs on our planet is called attachment to outcome. Attaching to the idea of the perfect romance where everything is this counter, constant, balanced move between the two, okay, being attached to that, and that doesn't happen, so then you blame. Since we human beings only marginally blame ourselves, but systematically blame everyone and everything else on the planet, what she's describing is the version of the blame game. She cannot tell where her own personal blame of what, you know, in the attachment to the ideal and the refusal to acknowledge that it is the ideal. It's just not a storybook ideal, but it's exactly what she and he create for themselves in order for the growth to occur for both.
That's very good.
Right. Now, the only thinking that's worthy of a human being, truly so, is the recognition of yourself as the source. If whatever that is so annoying, and we don't want to be humanoid anymore, we just want to be annoyed, whatever is so annoying, if you recognize yourself as the source of that, well, then it isn't even vaguely annoying. And once you recognize yourself as the source, you're then in the position to do something about it. So long as you assign the blame to the other person, then you're powerless in the situation. And I believe that's the crux of what Sue's talking about, the feeling of powerlessness within that system.
Well, I agree with that. I definitely agree that everything is a mirror. But I also, that I found very valuable in the Toltec teachings, which is take nothing personally, we are actually programmed to take everything personally. So how I use this when I'm talking to people that get lost in other people's stuff is we tend to use guilt manipulation with each other. So if someone in the relationship says, you know, you're always making me wait, I automatically, whatever I am telling somebody else when I'm upset, I have this default thing that says I am doing it. So if I say,
terrific,
you're always making me wait, I, in my head as I'm saying that, I say, I always make me wait. I can find the solution and I move through it. But what we tend to do when we're not living in that kind of consciousness is it is the blame game.
Oh yeah, that's the only game.
But it's also when we take things personally. So let me just say, if someone were to say, you're always making me wait, saying that to me, I would also hear that them saying to themselves that they're always making them wait. And so instead of me letting that trigger me and push my buttons so that I say, well, you made me wait last week, and get into one of those kind of things, if you don't take it personally, you can hear what they're actually saying. And they're saying that I am afraid that you don't love me enough, that you might forget me. And so you can actually address that. So when you sort out what's really their fear,
yeah,
and what that's telling you, like I was saying, sorting out like the piles of laundry, you can really get somewhere.
Yeah.
And you don't have to fight.
Yeah, and they're talking about them not loving themselves, mm-hmm, is the other.
But it's to recognize it in both ways, and so that's,
yeah,
kind of the sorting out.
That's
okay, this really doesn't belong to me.
To ask yourself why you are doing this to you, always, that's the thing. And, you know, of course, there's no such thing as weight. It has never been done in the history of mankind.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing, there never has been weight that's not. But this concept of recognizing yourself as the source in all things will catapult you forward exponentially in your life, because once you recognize you as the source, then suddenly you're in charge of it. As long as it's the blame game, you have no power. Now, the word paranoid, and we all know the word paranoid, The word paranoid means powerlessness. So whenever you are taking it personally, then you are feeling powerless. And the truth of the matter is, you never have been and you never will be powerless. It cannot be done. No one has ever done it. We have created this elaborate fiction of a language, the language codes books, and we apply this to ourselves to make ourselves seemingly powerless, but that's just not the way it is. You wake up to this, begin to change the words you think in, and your reality will change exponentially. It is the way this works. And we're going to be having a class coming up on the 23rd, that would be Saturday, on crystals.
Yeah, it's yeah, please do call us and let us know if you're interested. We'll be studying the property and uses of crystals, healing with crystals, and gridding, lots of different things, a lot's packed into that. And then on Sunday is Consciously Creating Your Life, and a lot of other things are posted on the web, telepathictv.com. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it really is important for us to get to that place where we have that perfect relationship with ourselves. And you know, that really is a journey. We're all on. There's nobody that's just, oh yes, I'm totally in perfect relationship with myself. And you know, everybody, it's something that we evolve, and it's actually very fun and rewarding to develop that relationship with yourself. And that's really the only reason we're here. And so our key personal relationships around us are great mirrors of really what's going on in there. Like that one morning I woke up hearing that the only eyes we cannot look into are our own. That's why we count on each other to be mirrors. So if we lovingly support each other in that role, instead of blaming or getting lost in the reflection, it really works well. Well, mm-hmm. I have another question.
Okay.
But we do have a call. Okay. Well,
right,
we will do the call first.
Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
This is Neha calling.
Neha, what can we do for you?
Hi, I wanted to ask you a question. How would you define the word love?
Love.
And what is your experience with love?
Well, extensive. In the next...
I'll hang up. Thank you.
Okay.
In writing the hidden language codes, I was looking for a synonym for the word love, and probably 2 years in the search, because English has love and I like you a lot, and that's about it for the concept. French, Arabic languages, I believe, I love you, Mary was saying the other day, I love you as my sister, I love you as my... brother, I love you as my parent, etc. There are many ways to say, but in English it really is just I love. So the only word I found that was synonymous with the word love is a fictional word, and the word is risk.
A door,
yes, also a window sometimes, depending if you just want to look or actually come through the door and become involved. But the idea of risk, which isn't a real word, because there is no such thing, because it is indeed a safe existence, a safe universe. And risk. Now, the interesting thing, and who would have thought the lottery companies to have come up with any deep philosophy, but nonetheless they have, when they say, if you don't play, you cannot win. And that is very much an attitude about love that I would espouse, stating that if you don't get in the game and love someone, there is no possibility of the win. So as long as we are excluding ourselves from love through whatever extensive shutting of doors in our heart we have, quote, accomplished, as long as we don't allow ourselves to open up and love, then we're out of the game, we're playing the bench. And I believe the human race as an overall whole has a functioning broken heart. We get in and out of love, but we don't allow ourselves the risk factor. We don't allow ourselves to fully, full body love, full experience of love. We just play the margins wherever we can without that commitment. Because of the enormous history of broken hearts that we've had through so many lifetimes. So Mary and I are at the moment doing a past life class at AMC, Arlington Metaphysical Chapel, in which we are talking to people about the idea of allowing the love experience that is a very important factor, because we go back and find places where we have loved and lost and have the feeling, because of our being taught through body of evidence thinking, that if we love, it will be a disappointment again. We're bigger than that. We create everything. Create love in your life. Do this, absolutely.
Next call.
Mm-hmm. And we have, we have another caller?
An opera singer. Hi.
Hi, what's your name?
Hi, Marilyn.
Hi, Marilyn.
Marilyn, what can we do for you?
Can you hear me okay?
Come on. What can we do?
You might have to start over, Marilyn. I think they're adjusting the sound a little bit.
Okay, I'm right here.
Okay.
Hi. What can we do for you?
I actually had a question, and I'm enjoying the show this evening. A lot of the things that Mary's been talking about, we've talked about individually many, many times. So I definitely appreciate everything you're saying. I was wondering what your thoughts have been about this video and book called The Secret that a lot of people are talking about. Have you heard much about it's been a recently published book called The Secret.
We've been teaching everything. First of all, they don't give you the secret, or you'd be able to levitate by the end of the movie. And we've been teaching everything that's on that for 100 years. More than that, you can find all of this universal truth knowledge written in the 30s, written in the 60s, written in the 80s, written in the 90s, been written in this century, that this movie has served to raise the base level. Dunk. Okay. But come on, let's go. This is not... It's good that it exists, because it explains it to that many more people. The point is the actual application of this. The point is the change in the way in which you think. The point is recognizing everything as a blessing. Not that there's a movie out. Marilyn, how does this work in your life? Since you've seen the movie, are you exponentially more creative?
Well, I've heard a lot of people that because it's so, the secret is so commercial and it's so mainstream, that a lot of people, I know many people in the area that have been teaching these principles.
Yeah.
Frankly, they've been around forever, because these are the principles of life.
Yeah.
But a lot of people are advertising it and promoting it and teaching it under that cover, because that's the commercial thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think in part, while there's a little bit of frustration when people bring that up, or what the bleep is, that... We've been bringing that to the area for many years, and it seems like sometimes to us that we've been speaking this, and obviously people haven't heard it. it seems that way, and I think that might be what part of the frustration in your voice was, not at you, Marilyn, or not at the movie, but just a little bit of frustration over having been teaching this and very few people recognize it. So
here's how this works. You have to tell a human being something 2,000 times. And then they think it's their own idea. And I think it's the mixed secret.
The mixed secret, yeah.
The mixed secret. You still there?
No, I think... She is?
Something's still there.
Okay.
Answer your question?
But you know, these principles, the fundamental principles that we create our own reality, that we are decision makers of it, a lot of people, you know, ask us also about the Abraham Hicks books and things like that.
It's another one.
And all this information I got many years ago with the Seth material, which to me is the foundation of all metaphysical teachings. And even before that, it came with Ledbetter in the 1800s. And, and Catherine Ponder and Florence Scovel Shinn in the 1920s. I mean, this whole law of attraction thing, it's more than just holding that in your mind. We must also get to the point where we drop the beliefs that are keeping it away from us. You know, as much as we'd like to visualize a fancy car, it will come to you, absolutely. But, you know, I've told this story many years ago where I did this exercise I had read in a book, probably in the early 80s, where you write down what it is you'd like to create. And I wrote down a new blue car, and I folded it up. And then you imagine dropping it in the mail slot, and it just goes away, and that it's going to come. And what that exercise does is, if you can't let go of it, it really lets you see, what are my doubts about this? You know, like, oh, I don't believe this is possible, or what? So number one, it revealed your doubts so that you could release them, but then let go of it. And then I found, like, 12 years later, I had a brand new blue car I'd bought in 97, the Civic. Yeah. And I thought, well, you know, it always comes. It just took a long time. But these fundamental principles, we really have to get down to a lot of the things we teach in the Consciously Creating Your Life. What is it that I am believing in? It, you know, but it's very good that it's getting out there. But do we have another call?
Yeah.
Can you hear me still?
Yes,
we can.
Hey, Marilyn.
Marilyn, come to Consciously Creating Sunday.
Yeah. Believe me, I just was bringing it up because I think it's interesting to talk about the secret, but I agree with you. It's just that people are so distracted. I think they finally, it's nothing new, really.
No, it isn't even vaguely new. The point is the application of it in the reality of your life.
Yeah, and well, what it is too is I think the average person really responds better to a commercially packaged product, and they tend to believe in that more rather than just two people here or there, or what they personally believe. But either way, if that's what it takes, is to have a commercial product like that, with the legitimacy of the so-called, you know, scientists behind it, then all the better. If that's the way we had to get through, to drill through, to raise consciousness, it's just showing you that there were a number of people that were here for a long time that didn't have to have this legitimacy of some scientist to stating this, that, you know, metaphysics always precedes science and physics. It always has, and it always will. And so I just think it's wonderful, more people opening up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and you're right, Marilyn. You know, it's a good, since it's a commercially acceptable thing, it's a good starting point for a great conversation. So what more can you get there?
If you have time later, Mary, could I get a reading?
Sure,
thanks.
Sure.
Okay,
thanks.
Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Yeah, very much so.
Yeah. Well, do we have another call, or shall we go? Well, Ray, our dear friend Ray from Pennsylvania, who still watches us on the internet, wrote, if this is a friendly place and that the universe is on our side, why is it that our past lives are hidden from us? Why not remember them and grow? And I remember when I was a kid, I thought, why, if God, I mean, because God, if it is the creator of all this, then why would he make it, or she make it, so that we have these terrible things wrong with us? Like, why not just make us perfect? So I guess he's kind of coming from the place, why are our past lives hidden from us, since they offer so much valuable information in our growth?
Well, we have not grown yet to the point that we are allowed to recall our past lives. For example, if walking down the street and you saw a stranger who in some past life murdered you, you would tend to run away, which would actually prevent that soul from making amends, who was about to hand you a magnificent present. This person you see walking down the street towards you would have made that up to you, but for, so we are not trusting ourselves, as I recognize myself as source of everything. I don't trust me enough to have at my fingertips all of my past life remembering, which kind of I do, and most of the time I'm not so interested, because basically, as far as that goes, the question is, what have you done lately?
Well, I think
related to past lives. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was born remembering a good many of my past lives. I still remember it. I remember before I was born opening up map books and selecting all the way, drilling down until I was in this solar system, this planet, and where. And actually, I'll continue that maybe after the duck. Is that what we're waiting on?
A post-duck continuance.
Okay, so we'll go ahead and do the duck, and then I'll finish what I was saying, but we'll wait. Maureen, don't listen to me. Listen to Dad. Okay, there's Maureen, our wonderful red-headed duck dangler tonight. Stability.
And that is about...
You know, finding your center is where you're stable. It's not anything to do with your external surroundings. What was yours?
True beauty, which is truly in the eye of the beholder.
The more beauty you see, the more beautiful you are.
Yeah, that is the way the whole entire principle works.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's great. Thank you, Maureen. And this whole thing about past lives, I actually, you know, did come in remembering them, and I feel like we are capable of remembering our past lives and still functioning in this life as a separate component, just like you can remember being in elementary school and you can still function in intermediate school, and you could still remember your friends then, and you may run into those friends again in high school, but you change and you grow. And I think it's mainly a matter of we have to get to the consciousness state, the place in evolution. We have to get there, and then we really will. And I think more and more kids, you know, we may call them indigo and crystal children and everything, but more and more kids are coming in with their awareness of past lives, like I did way back in the 50s. I mean, I knew then. And so more and more kids are. My nephew, my sister had called me years ago when my nephew was 2 years old, because she was just laying there with him, get him to take his nap. And he says, "Do you remember when I used to be your husband?" And she, you know, he was 2 years old. He didn't even really know that word. So I think we're ascending and we're growing into that point.
I'm going to start my own movement, and I'm going to be an azure child. There we go. Always have been, always
that's
will
very,
be.
That's very indigo-ish.
No, we're a sub-branch there.
Oh,
the
okay.
Azure. Okay. Hi, caller. What's
your
name, please?
Hi, this is Lisa.
Lisa, what can we do for you?
I'd like to get a reading.
Okay.
For my granddaughter, Taylor.
Okay, for your granddaughter, Taylor?
My granddaughter, Taylor. Last week you did Marissa.
Oh, okay.
And you were right on target with that. So
oh,
Taylor
good.
Is very
wonderful.
Curious to see what you have to say here.
Okay. Well, here's for Taylor. The first card we get is the morality. And one thing that this is telling me is that she is very, very conscious of other people's feelings and everything going on around her. So sometimes she might be a little hard on herself because she wants everybody to be happy. And so she'll kind of like sacrifice what she wants so that the whole can be happy. And so card comes to say, just, you know, in one way, there's a way for us to be focused and really be who we are and what we would like to be in life. But then there comes a point where that weighs us down. And so it's just reminding her to let go of that, because she has everything that she requires to be and do whatever she would like. And that I know we all do, but she's got it and she'll really realize that in this life. So it's really a wonderful thing, the success, the supreme tiger walking, you know, the over earth like that. And so a lot of things going on in her life right now, she's going to find it will be very successful. This creativity, this is where getting rid of the judgment, because she has a lot of artistic abilities, creative abilities, but it may not be in any kind of thing that's been done before. You know, like when Picasso first did his painting, there had never been anything like that before. So to remain open and just temporarily suspend any judgment on her creativity. I think you're going to see some wonderful things. So thank you very much. And shall I just do Marilyn's real quick?
So that sure.
Okay. Did you want to say anything first before
nope.
I do? Okay. Let's do, so Marilyn. Okay, we'll do that and then we can move on to whatever. The first card is silence. And, you know, and I do know you, Marilyn, because we've talked a number of times on the phone. And this card is confirming that water energy is really good for you. And so continue to get out there and get on the water and, you know, getting out in the sun and just being out there, because you're more of a person that just does well with being outside, being out in that energy. The letting go is, this is the time where we decide what it is we'd like and we turn it over to the universe and not get tied up into the how-tos right now, because that's not our job, that's the universe's job. You just keep focusing on what. And that's where, you know, some things are going to really open up. I feel in regards to your job too, things are going to really open up, and things are just opening up, so I would just be ready for that and not to hold on to the how-tos.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, did you want to talk about your thing? Or
oh, well, as we see at the end of the show, this is the waveform generator. And it puts
elf
out
generator.
Elf generator. And it puts out a frequency. There we go. And many people have told us about the literally miraculous change. So take this energy, There we go. And transmute it into something beautiful for yourself. It is a gift. And it does go very well right through the television.
It does.
We've had people talk about
their backs getting better, their hips, their knees, all kinds of different things.
Calling allies into the life has been done quite a bit with these things. It amounts to a megaphone. It is a sound into energy device, sound into matter device.
It's lovely.
So things spoken through it will tend to manifest, like our next caller, evidently. Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
Hi, this is Lee.
Hi, Lee.
How are you?
Hey, good. Great. How are you?
Good. Can I get a reading from Mary?
Sure.
Thanks.
Be happy to.
I'll hang up.
Oh, what was that?
I'll hang up.
Just a general? Okay.
Okay.
Okay, great. Thanks, Lee. All right. The first card, the fighting, and you know, we were talking earlier about everything outside is a reflection of inside. Fighting always is something going on inside, like two opposing thoughts. And you know, none of us have completely mastered that, or we probably wouldn't be here. We wouldn't be doing the things we do in life. So in other words, it's saying look in within you and see, where is this fundamental conflict? What am I fighting? Is there a part of me that would really like to step out and do something completely new, and the other part fighting, saying, oh no, that's not safe, anything having to do with that? And I really do feel like that's what it's talking about. Like, now's the time to really break out of some old patterns and old things. And it's saying that get your passions back. It feels like part of my passions may have gotten a little lost over, you know, my intellectual meanderings have kind of suppressed some of my passions. And so now's time to call it up, because that's the driving force that will take you to wherever you'd like to go. And you have a lot to share about your journey getting there also. And so keep an open heart, shine your light. In other words, just come out and just be in the sun. I just see you out there teaching, talking, and just really being there, out present in your life. It just feels really good. It feels like I was kind of cold and now I'm getting really warm.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for calling.
Yeah, on the 30th of this month, we're going to be doing Future Lives, which is talking about the rest of this life and the idea of what it is you would begin to design in future lives, which is a very, very telling, very exciting event. And that's followed by the quartz crystal bowls, which is something Mary does readings with, which tune, activate the chakra system. We as a race have no concept of how out of tune we are. Well, that sound, oh yeah, that was a siren. Someone urging sailors to their death? No, a police siren. Again, someone urging sailors to their death? Oh no, there's no connection between the two words. None whatsoever. Okay, discordance would be yes, absolutely. So if you are bored, if you don't recognize at all that you're out of tune, fine. If you're starting to go, oh gee, you know, there could be some vague notion of a reality in which I'm perhaps slightly, ever so slightly out of tune, and I would like to proactively do something about getting myself, my chakra system, and therefore my life, open, functioning, and tuned, why then, and in harmony, yes, the harmonic of your life. This is a harmony universe. Whatever harmony you give off is the harmony that comes back. I believe many of us have noticed that there have been patterns repeating themselves. There it is again, repeating themselves in our life. Yes, oh, okay. Well, if we don't like that pattern, that has happened on occasion.
We dye it a different color.
Yes, there we go. And so that's very much the consciously creating your life is where we're doing that, you know, getting to the next phone call. But to go to telepathictv.com now and
not
look.
Yet, after the show.
You can watch it. You can watch an episode right next to this one. Okay. Anyhow, I believe we have our next caller. Rumor has it. Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
Hi. This is Merced. And I was wondering if I could have a reading from Mary regarding health. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Regarding health. Just see here.
Is our caller still on the line? Maybe we can do the specifics.
I didn't believe so.
No?
Let me do this part first we get into that, because, you know, it really is good to, the less information, the better. Well, suppression, you know, and I immediately kept thinking of immune or something like that, you know, like immune suppression of certain things. When we hold back our voice, when we suppress who it is we are, it really does suppress other things in our system. And so this is saying that when we start living our life, looking at our path through the eyes of other people, which is really our idea of other people, we are no longer funding our path directly. And that's when things in the body start going through different iterations to get our attention to say, hey, pull your energy, pull your life force back in here. This innocence is talking about, it may seem like you've been to certain doctors or you've been through certain things over and over and it doesn't feel like it's getting better. I feel like there's something or someone, some technique that you can find that's just going to really change things just overnight, because healing really is instantaneous. We've got to get rid of our belief that it takes a long time to heal. We can believe that we can bump our leg and it would hurt instantly, but we think, oh, it takes weeks for that bump to heal. Let's just start looking at it differently, and it will change a lot of things. I feel, you know, Neville and I are going to be doing a class teaching about how spiritual reasons for disease and where you can come in, and we actually help everybody kind of through their personal ones. We do shows about that a lot. And really, once you get the message, I would say just ask your body, and this is true for everyone, just lay down and ask your body what it has to say to you, and just kind of make your consciousness run from feet to head. And it will really give you the information. Once you get it and these old beliefs, limiting beliefs, fall away, your life really does change. And I feel like there's so much creativity and things in you that you've been holding back, that people have told you that weren't good enough or whatever, these points of view that were outside.
Mm-hmm.
That once you drop that, it just feels like a lot of energy rushing in.
Yes, any disease that any human being has a correlation to a spirit lesson that they are summarily refusing to get. And we have for many shows and invite people, even our preceding caller, if there's an interest in this, whatever the disease is, it has something that you have to get a hold of that is a piece of your evolution that is written in your incarnational contract, and your refusal to get this causes the physical body to go so out of alignment as to be called disease. And once you get that lesson, the disease leaves. It has no job anymore. And we're doing vibrational healing on the 14th of next month coming up. Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
Hi, my name is Linda.
Hi, Linda.
Could I please get a reading?
Okay.
I'm going to go ahead and hang up.
Okay. Thank you. Let's see. Okay. You know, I this is probably why it just made me smile when I was picking the cards. I just felt like smiling that there's been so much growth and so much is coming into resonance. This shows this beautiful picture of the heart and the head being in resonance with each other. And when our heart is no longer fighting our head and our head is no longer fighting our heart, which usually it's just the head been given responsibility to maintain this huge, wonderful, vast heart, and it just can't keep up. When we let go of that battle and let them live together and respect each of them, then our whole world starts turning like this. And look at these beautiful blues, the blues of the third eye and the blues of the throat chakra, where communication, where you're starting to see. The last piece in the puzzle gets put in place over the third eye, because the last piece of anything is the understanding of it. I'm not saying the last piece, you have to wait till the end to understand, but always there's that final understanding when that last piece is put into place. And look, we got more blues for you. You are really having your throat chakra opening, and this is wonderful. And the dream, focusing on our dreams, there's nothing wrong with that. But when we start saying, I can't have my dreams, that my dreams exist in some other realm, and this world, I've just got to be unhappy, and I got to wait for that to come to me in my afterlife or something. This is saying, pull your dreams into now. It's okay to have them. You can make them right now. It's all one thing.
Yes, absolutely. Let's make some. Very good. We'll be doing a class on the Mayan calendar, the true calendar, the Earth calendar, the calendar that is what's actually going on as opposed to the Gregorian mess we've been taught. Towards the end of next month, I'll be doing the galactic history just prior to the Seichim initiations. Seichim is a very interesting subject. It is as ancient as it gets on our planet, at least in the modern, those that say this is the fifth world. Fine, I would say Seichim has been around since prior to the fifth world, significantly prior. And it is the ocean of energy that we all live in, and the acquisition, remembrance of the ability to conduct this energy through a fellow human being, for example, to result in a leap forward evolutionary, spiritually, physically, for said other human being or yourself if you wish to do it on yourself. Seichim is a very powerful and hot ticket. Again, more information on telepathictv.com.
You know, this last, for our last caller, Linda, those three cards had the blue of Seichim.
Seichim blue, yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So she might want to pursue that.
That's true. That really does come through. Today happens to be a blue day also, which I'm certain has something to do with it. Mm-hmm. The Seichim blue in particular is very similar to the robin's egg or the sky blue.
Yeah, it's a little lighter than
towards the blue that you're wearing. Yeah,
but very dynamic.
Yeah, it's interesting. We human beings do well. For whatever reason this was, and totally unknown to me, my father decided to paint all the ceilings in the house sky blue. And I was thinking he was interested in no corporate ceiling, which I do believe he managed to succeed in. But we human beings do well in blue, so if you have nothing to do and would like to paint your ceilings light blue, I would recommend it highly. You could even do cloud motifs up there and an occasional bird. And not just for the kids, I'm talking about the living room. Live your life, it's your life, live it.
You know, my friend Judy was an incredible artist. She passed into spirit realm 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. She's an incredible artist, and she painted murals all over her walls in her son's room, a tree with blue sky, with mm-hmm. clouds.
You know, there you go.
And then a tree with a cardinal sitting on it. In her mm-hmm. room, she painted this big flower that opened up on the ceiling.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, why not get creative? We don't have to have these, you know, color palettes with, you know, one wall. Do whatever. Get really creative with the colors and things on your walls. I mean, mm-hmm. they're like canvases all around us.
From drawings on cave walls on, mankind has been prone to anything to do with ancient Rome, and you got a mural right there. And they had, like, glorious architecture. Mm. It wasn't like, gee, I can't see outside, I'll paint a picture of a window. You know, which is kind of a modern, very lack mentality version of what we're talking about. We're talking about the essence of creativity.
I had that idea years ago. I thought it was great. I wanted to paint a picture.
Yeah, paint a picture.
And then another idea I had is to put a privacy, like those tall wooden privacy fences. I wanted to paint a beach scene on this one, and then on the side ones, a perspective that looked like it was going down the beach. So when you mm-hmm. sat in your backyard, it would look like everywhere you looked was a beach.
Sounds exciting.
Yeah.
So, come join us at Ruby Tuesdays. The one that is in Fairfax Circle will be there shortly after the show, meaning, 9:45, really. We usually have packed all this up and are on our way. If that interests you, we're always talking about go to telepathictv.com. Mary has been so kind as to have archived a number of shows there, an ever-growing number of shows there. And so that you can get a hold of this.
I also have audio versions of many of the shows on iTunes that you can mm-hmm. listen to on your computer, even if you don't have an iPod, for mm-hmm. free, for people with low bandwidth.
Yeah.
That they can listen to the audio version. Or you can put them on your iPods and listen to us on the Metro.
Yes. And we have freely and gloriously and joyously been giving the cutting edge of consciousness. You want the cutting edge, you're creating this. Okay, own it and act like that. There's the cutting edge right there. We are relentlessly teaching what is new, and all of this stuff that is being repeated by everyone, that's it. But I'm telling you that this is your doctorate version of consciousness here. This show in particular is imparting information that's not really around, that's not really so common, and we're giving it freely. Tune it in. There it is. And if there's someone you really don't like, recommend our show to them. Because nothing gets even like waking somebody up. Cutting edge, I'm telling you. Make them conscious. It'll fix them good.
Well, it's our joy and honor to take you to the door tonight. Thank you for all of our callers.
Yes, your choice to go through it. And
and thanks to Maureen, the duck dangler.
Yes, and email us some questions. We would love to do that.